Welcome to the Inside Story on the Reproductive System. Adam, our computer public is calling us. They want to take a look at conception and reproduction.
It's a little late now, don't you think? You're already 40 weeks pregnant.
It'll be fine. We can show them what we each did in preparation for conceiving the baby. And then we can show them what we did together to make it happen. They can even see some home animations of the baby inside me. I'll begin as soon as they click on the picture. As you see, I used to be a lot smaller. Then Adam and I decided to make a baby, and everything changed. I've been practicing for conception for a long time, at least in terms of getting an egg to the right place at the right time. Take a quick look at some of my key reproductive organs, and then I'll tell you more about it. Here are my uterus, ovaries, fallopian tubes, and vagina. Let's enlarge an ovary to get a better view of a developing egg. You can see an open view into my ovary on the left. The purple structures inside it are developing eggs, or oocytes. Since I was born, all of the eggs that I'll ever produce have been sitting inside of my ovaries in an undeveloped form. Approximately once a month, from the time I was about 12, hormonal messages from my brain caused my ovaries to develop an egg for fertilization, while other hormones instructed my uterine lining to thicken in preparation for nourishing a fertilized egg. There are several hormones that regulate my reproductive cycle. Among these are estrogen, progesterone, FSH, or follicle-stimulating hormone, and LH, or luteinizing hormone. I'll tell you more about each of these in a moment. Take a look at this follicle growing within my ovary. A follicle is an egg which is surrounded by the support cells that nourish it. To prepare my egg for fertilization, FSH causes it to begin dividing its genetic material, or chromosomes. This is the beginning of my reproductive cycle. The follicle then releases estrogen, the hormone that prepares the lining of the uterus to receive a fertilized egg. Increased levels of estrogen in my brain, the pituitary gland, to stop releasing the hormone FSH and to start releasing LH. LH causes the follicle to enlarge rapidly and to release its egg in a process known as ovulation. There goes an egg now. Once it's out of the follicle begins secreting the hormone progesterone, which also helps to prepare the uterine lining for the fertilized egg. The large structure on the right that looks a bit like an aquatic plant is the entrance to my fallopian tube. The smaller, waving structures at its opening are called fimbriae. They're moving a lot because it's their job to sweep the egg into the fallopian tube's entrance and toward the uterus. Meanwhile, the remaining cells of my follicle shrink into a hormone-producing mass of cells. On its way to the uterus, one of two things may happen to my egg. It will either become fertilized by a sperm cell, or it won't. If my egg becomes fertilized, it usually occurs in my fallopian tube. From there, it's transported to the uterus and implants itself in the uterine wall, where it's nourished by my uterine lining. In my ovary, the remaining cells of the follicle produce progesterone so that my egg can develop into a fetus. If my egg is not fertilized within 24 hours after its release from my ovary, it stops developing and dissolves before reaching the uterus. The absence of a fertilized egg causes my body to stop releasing the hormones that prepare my uterus for implantation. In response, my uterus sheds its lining over a period of 4 to 5 days, in a process known as menstruation. As you can see, the hormones which control my reproductive system maintain a delicate balance over the life cycle of my egg. So, that's pretty much what I did to get an egg ready and in place for our baby's conception. Adam, why don't you show them what you did?
I'm ready. They just have to click on the picture to get details on the production and pathway of sperm.
Thank you.
You can't produce a product without the right equipment. And I have the standard male reproductive components. Here, you can see for yourselves. Here are my testes, urethra, vas deferens, prostate, seminal vesicle, and penis. My testes are actually made up of coiled structures called seminiferous tubules, which are the sites of my sperm production. The structure on top of the seminiferous tubules is the epididymis. My sperm migrate there to mature and then are stored there afterwards. I'll just put this testicle back in a safe place before we continue. First, my penis fills with blood and becomes erect. Then, with sufficient stimulation, an ejaculatory process begins. Here you can see the mature sperm traveling from my epididymis through my vas deferens, a muscular tube which propels sperm forward through smooth muscle contractions. My sperm arrive first at my ampulla, where secretions from my seminal vesicle are added. From the ampulla, seminal fluid is propelled forward through my ejaculatory ducts toward my urethra, passing first by my prostate, where a milky fluid is added to form semen. Finally, the semen is ejected out, or ejaculated, through the far end of my urethra. I think you can appreciate that Eve and I each did some real preparation for our baby's conception. Just click on the picture to see how we put all that preparation to good use.
Dr. Harper, if males release millions of sperm, why do only a few hundred reach the egg?
Although a male releases up to 500 million sperm into the vagina, a long and hazardous journey awaits them before they can reach the egg. First, millions of sperm leak out of the vagina. Next, acids inside the vagina destroy most of the remaining sperm. Of those that survive the vaginal acids, many are destroyed by cells in the woman's immune system called phagocytes. Eventually, a few hundred reach the part of the uterine tube where the egg awaits. Of the sperm that reach the egg, only one will fertilize it.
During intercourse, my sperm are released into Eve's vagina near the cervix, which is the entrance to the uterus. Here you can see my sperm swimming through Eve's uterus and up her fallopian tubes. From their profiles, you can see the sperm actually have three parts, a head, a middle section, and a tail, which helps them to swim a lot better.
Here's my egg moving through my fallopian tube. Within my fallopian tube, my egg was met by hundreds of Adam sperm. It was really an impressive turnout. Finally, one of the sperm succeeded in breaking through the egg's outer membrane. It united with the nucleus from my egg, and our baby was conceived. After my egg was fertilized, our baby began to grow quickly. It took about 40 weeks for the baby to fully develop. Here we've sped the process up a bit for you to view it in its entirety. About halfway through my pregnancy, Adam and I went to our physician to get an ultrasound examination. Listen carefully and you can hear the sound of our baby's heartbeat. During this procedure, sound waves were used to see how our baby was developing inside my uterus. The image was then displayed on a video screen. This actual video footage shows the baby moving around inside my uterus. Look, where the arrow is pointing, you can see the legs moving up and down, bending at the knees.
Wow, it sure is.
Ouch! Now I remember how much it hurt when the baby kicked me. Fortunately, our physician said our baby looked perfectly normal for a 20-week-old fetus. My 40-week pregnancy was divided into three distinct time periods, or trimesters. To understand what each trimester was like for me and my baby, click on the picture. During my first trimester, which was the first 14 weeks of my 40-week pregnancy, I became unusually emotional due to the hormonal changes in my body. My breasts became enlarged and tender, and I had morning sickness at all times of the day and night. My baby did just fine during this period. Nearly all of his internal organs had already formed, even though he'd only grown to about the size of my fist. He could even begin to move a little. During the second trimester, the nausea eased up, but was replaced by heartburn and indigestion. The bulge of my stomach became very noticeable, and I developed stretch marks as the skin of my abdomen expanded. My baby grew very rapidly during this period, and his arms and legs became well-developed and strong. I even began to feel him moving inside me. Although he was almost fully formed, his lungs needed to develop further, and he needed to fatten up quite a bit before he could be born. The third trimester was the home stretch, but it seemed to last forever. I was quite bulky and clumsy, and found it hard to find a comfortable position either awake or asleep. At one point, I'd grown so large, my navel even popped out. Close to the time of my delivery, my baby's growing body pushed my abdominal organs up under my diaphragm, which was not very pleasant. But eventually, my baby dropped down into my pelvic cavity, which was nature's way of saying, it's time to give birth.
What do you mean the contractions are starting?